Opium is the cheapest thing to get on the street these days, which is why there's been a rise of addiction to it again. It's on the rise again.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because it's accessible, it's economic, it's cheap. It's not expensive like cocaine or anything else.
Mm-hmm. We're in lockdown as well.
Yeah. So during the time of the Bush administration, the decision came down, okay, and we can't stop them from buying it, but we can eliminate a chunk of the customer base that is buying it by making it more expensive. Now, how do you make it more expensive? Well, it's the simple laws of supply and demand. So you know that the people growing it are family-run businesses in Afghanistan.
Mm.
What do you do? Well, you go to those families like you would any other farmer in the United States who you pay not to grow certain crops. You pay them not to grow food, as utterly asinine as that is, as it sounds. You do the same thing with the farmers in Afghanistan who are, no, they're not growing corn and wheat, they're just growing opium. But you treat them the same way. We will pay you to burn your crops and minimize the growth. Cut down on your supply, cut down on your crops. Make it more expensive because there's less available. So they did that. Great program. The prices of heroin on the street rose. The addiction levels went down immediately because there weren't as many people who could afford it.
Mm-hmm.
Sometime later, the word came down, okay, we are in the war with Afghanistan and Pakistan. All of a sudden, it was just like, oh, we're going to use drones to bomb the shit out of them. Well, the people who were being bombed were the family members of the farmers who were asked not to grow those crops.
Mm.
Okay. Well, they saw that coming from the United States and they felt like, screw it, the trust has been broken, the deal is broken, we're going back to growing more heroin. Well, sure enough, you grow more, the prices drop on the streets in America and the addiction
mm-hmm.
goes through the roof again.
Mm-hmm.
That was their way of getting even with us for bombing their families.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we had a good thing going with minimizing the cost of supply and demand, but then, you know, we go bombing them for no apparent reason. And then it's just like, because we think their families are associated with terrorists. And sure enough, the farmers struck back. They said, okay, we're not going to burn our crops anymore.
Yeah.
And that's how the heroin epidemic went skyrocketing through the roof. Since about probably 2010, over the past 10 years.
Right. And Bush was involved in a lot of, Bush and Clinton were involved in a lot of that smuggling themselves, weren't they? It was done through, Clinton's up through Arkansas. They had planes and I think it was Arkansas it was going through. I don't remember the name of the town, but it was Amino or something like that. I can't remember the name of the town. Amino, Arkansas or something like that. But the Clinton and Bush, the Clintons and Bushes were, they were in opposition in the election, but in business they were not.
Mm-hmm. Right. Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, that's classic.
They were playing golf together. They were on
Air Force One
together. So.
Right, right. So that's a classic. That's classic. That's the problem of. That's a classic American politics. You know, where you have these. You think you've got two parties. You don't. You don't have two parties.
Hmm. I know. What's funny is that when those pictures came up, and you tried to confront Republicans with that, they're like, "Oh, that was photoshopped. Really?
Yeah.
I'm a graphic designer. That was not photoshopped. Okay, that's a genuine photograph. Okay, so there's no photoshopping going on there."
Right. What would you say? I know you're a graphic designer too, like you just as you just said. What would you say the effects are upon that area of being an artist? I mean, with all what, I mean, if we had full powers, what we would create would be incredible. So what would you say are the effects of, you know, this whole environment that we live in? How do you think, you know, as yourself, as an artist, how would you say that affects your work, or in a negative and positive ways?
The way I've seen it affect me or affect the artwork over the years is that you're going to have people who look at the social themes I have in my artwork, and they'll be like, that's not what it's about, because they're in denial about the idea that there's a common ground between the profane and the mundane, the politics and society here on Earth and our culture versus extraterrestrial contact.
Right.
A lot of people see extraterrestrial contact as some kind of anathema or cure to everything you want to escape from. And like, that's not the case. You guys are in for a sad awakening when you realize that everything you've been using the paranormal and UFO arena to as a cheap form of escapist entertainment, that means you're not really taking a good look at the rearview mirror and seeing what's sneaking up behind you.
Mm.
So I've seen that. I've seen it criticized the other way, like, why are you associating these controversial issues with something as idiotic as aliens? You know, that's happened too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's happened the other way as well. I was like, well, it's not idiotic. Cause and effect, action and reaction. Where do you think all these problems came from in the first place?
Mm.
We did not invent the light bulb. We did not invent the stock market, okay? These were all things that were handed down to us thousands of years ago. Okay, we did not invent the iPad. The iPads were around 5-10,000 years ago. Okay, smoke glass buildings. We're just repeating the same mistakes again because we didn't learn from the past.
There's nothing new under the sun.
Right, and what's, you know, what's old is new again. And yeah, we seem to think we're at the apex of scientific advancement. Well, we were at the apex 50,000 years ago as well.
Mm-hmm.
We were at the apex 100,000 years ago. So, you know, but we have this false narrative that's been invented that we look like us and Cro-Magnon and Neanderthal looked different. And yet we can't seem to explain the broken story that's in the strata, in the fossil record. Okay, if that's true, then how come I see high-tech devices, ancient geodes, capacitors, circuit boards, whatever, buried right alongside the skull of what's supposed to be, allegedly, my primate ancestor?
Mm.
Okay, go ahead and explain that. Well, that's an anomaly we're not going to look at. Oh, you're not going to look at it. Okay. And I suppose you don't want to look at the 1,000 years of technological advancement that was witnessed in Mesopotamia, Iran, Iraq, okay, all them, that ran parallel to the 1,000 years of Dark Ages and medieval stupidity of Europe. Why don't we ever hear about this high-tech age in Mesopotamia? Because the history books camouflage it with the Black Plague, bubonic plague, the Dark Ages of Europe. We focus on that garbage, but we don't seem to realize that what was running parallel to that same 1,000 years is a high level of technological advancement by Arabians, Mesopotamians.
Well, Africans really are.
Right. Nobody wants to talk about that because, that's forbidden. They're dark-skinned. They're Mesopotamians. That wasn't supposed to exist. Because if Europeans were in the Dark Ages, then there's no reason to look at anything else that was more advanced.